PreSonus recently dropped Studio One 5.3, and today we're gonna take a look and see what's new. So this update wasn't huge, but we did get some cool new stuff. Now, in this video, I will only be covering the things that I, as a music producer, find interesting. Nonetheless, I'll still be linking some videos down below in the description from PreSonus that cover the remaining features. Let's dive in. Okay, so let's start off with my favorite new feature, and that is the chord track drag and drop. Now listen, I've been asking for this feature for quite a while now, and I think I actually even included it in my Studio One wishlist video, which you can watch right up here, and PreSonus finally delivered, so I'm super pumped for this. Now, the way this works is exactly how you would expect. Once you have some chords up on the chord track, all you have to do is drag them down to the timeline, and they immediately get converted into MIDI notes that you can manipulate. The possibilities are endless, but when I see this, I immediately think of working with samples or some sort of loops. So let me show you how that process would look like for me. Okay, so first I would bring in a loop that I like. In this case, it's one from Murda Beats' new splice pack, and I would drop it into my timeline. Now, luckily for me, Murda did label this loop, so we know it's in G minor, but let's assume we know nothing. From here, I can right-click on my loop, go over to audio, and then hit extract to chord track. Now, you can select detect chords first and then extract the chord track, but that just creates an extra step. By selecting extract the chord track first, not only will it detect the chords, but also open up the chord track and bring those chords up to it. Okay, so here we see that it detected two kinds of G minor chords, the regular and the seventh. Now, from here, if you double click on any one of these chords on the chord track, you can activate the audition button. So now you can click on that chord on the chord track and hear what it would sound like. So let's take a listen to the sample and see which chord would fit best. Now for this example, I think the G minor regular triad works the best. So I'm going to delete the seventh, extend this over, and then from here, it's as simple as taking this chord and dragging it down to whatever VST you want, and immediately you get presented with the MIDI notes that you can then further manipulate. This is huge because with the MIDI now available, you can use it to create additional layers with different sounds and VSTs and continue to effortlessly build your beat. Again, this has been one of my most anticipated features, so a huge shout out to PreSonus for this one. Next up, we have new sound variation updates and musical symbols, and these are good if you're a composer and you need to change between patches on the fly or further adjust how a note is played. Sound variations were introduced in version 5, and they basically allow you to change the articulation of a sound either by triggering that articulation via a key on your MIDI keyboard or by programming it into the piano roll. This update brings that same kind of functionality but to MIDI channels, so now you can do that same kind of switching but with different patches or sounds. Let me show you how that works in Kontakt. So I'm going to start by opening up Kontakt here, and I'm going to load it with a few different patches that I might want to use for my project. Now here I've picked three random ones just to demonstrate this, but once that's done, close this VST up and open up a MIDI event. Now I've already created one with MIDI notes just to demonstrate, but once here, go to the left and click on this little wrench icon next to sound variations. From here, you'll be presented with the sound variations menu, and all you have to do here is start adding the different patches you want to use. So then since I have three different patches, I'm going to start by going to the bottom left here and clicking on new variation. From here, you can name it whatever you want. So I'm gonna do that myself. And I believe the first patch that I had was a bassoon. So we're gonna do that. And then we're gonna go to the bottom right here to where you see activation sequence and change the note on and off to channel change. Finally, change the data from reset to whatever channel number that you need by clicking and dragging up or down. So for me, that would be channel one. From here, repeat the process for the remaining patches by once again going to the bottom left and hitting new sound variation and renaming it. But notice how this time the new variation follows the previous activation sequence, so you don't have to input it again. Once you add a second one, it knows you want to use channel change and it automatically sets it to the following channel. So that would be here, channel two. Finally, you can choose to keep or change the input key, but once you've done that, you're done. From here, simply play and switch between patches using the input keys. Of course, you can always also just program the sound variations in the piano roll, so as the notes play, the patch switches where you programmed it. It's also important to note here that you can also do this with hardware synths, so switching between patches there just makes that entire process so much smoother. The next big thing here is that you could also now add musical symbols to the musical editor, either in the piano roll or the score view, to let you further manipulate how a sound or a note is played. Let me show you how that works in the piano roll. To do that here, simply go to the bottom of the piano roll and press the plus button if this window is not already open for you. If you want to see two windows at once, say for example the sound variations and then the musical symbols, all you have to do is press that plus button again and then change whatever you want to see from the tabs up here in that respective window. Now for the musical symbols here, it's as easy as selecting a note and then going to the musical symbols window, which we just opened, and then clicking and selecting anything you want. So let me just do this tremolo and let's see how that sounds. Of course, you could always program these musical symbols to a key on a keyboard using the sound variations menu with the same process that I described earlier so that you can play them on the fly manually. Finally, there's also a new sound variations lane on the top here, which you can toggle to get a different perspective. Last but not least, we have new ways to archive and save our sessions. Now, if you head over to the file menu here, there is a new convert to option, which basically allows you to convert your sessions to either an AAF file, capture sessions, MIDI file, OpenTL, and even a zip file. The zip option in particular is great because it also saves all reference media and gives you the option to use lossless audio file compression. This is super handy for sharing files between collaborators. Speaking of sharing files, if you're a Sphere member, you also have the option to upload your session to a workspace, which other users can then download directly to Studio One from the Cloud tab in the browser. And there you have it. Those are my three favorite new features from Studio One 5.3. There were two more features, which included updates to the show page, and we now also have MPE support for VST instruments. Now, I don't use either of those two, but again, I'll be linking some videos from PreSonus down below where they cover these two features in detail. But that's it for me. Thank you so much for watching. And as always, like this video if you like to subscribe if you're not already, but I'll see you on the next one.